Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Whole Bible Story, Everything That Happens in the Bible in Plain English, by Dr. William H. Marty, narrated by Jim Denison. Introduction. A friend recently asked me for a Bible. Knowing that she didn't know anything about it, I gave her a study Bible. She opened it and flipped through a few pages, and then looked up with a bewildered expression and asked, "How do I read this? Where do I start? What's in it?" I gave her a brief explanation and wrote down some of the biblical books she should start with, but I realized she needed more help than just this. Simply reading the Bible from cover to cover is a daunting task. The Bible is long, 66 books from Genesis to Revelation, and it can be difficult to follow the storyline because the books are not recorded in chronological order. Another challenge is content. The Bible is written in a variety of literary forms. In addition to historical narrative, there's poetry, law, prophecy, and parable. Epistles, letters, make up almost half of the New Testament. Many of the Old Testament's prophetical books, plus Revelation, are what we call apocalyptic literature. This type of writing describes catastrophic events associated with the end of time in vivid and bizarre imagery. For someone first attempting to read the Bible, this all can be very confusing. When you write a book, editors want you to be able to state its purpose in a sentence or two. Here's my attempt. The purpose of this book is to tell the story of the Bible. It is not a paraphrase of the Bible's 66 books. And it is not intended to replace Bible reading. My hope is that it will motivate people to read the Bible. This book skips important information. It is an effort to synthesize the storyline of the Old and New Testaments, minus the laws, messages, sermons, prophecies, and parables, stories. It does not include Old Testament poetry, wisdom literature, and prophecy. And it does not include the New Testament epistles. It is not a direct translation of the Bible. Instead, it tells the story in plain, simple English. With very little commentary, I'm trying to give just the facts, to tell the story as it is recorded. One thing to keep in mind, just because an event is recorded in the Bible does not mean God approves of it. The nature of historical narrative is to record what happened. The writers of Scripture assume the reader will look at events from God's perspective. I need to warn you up front also that reading the Bible will change you. It's not like reading other books. The Bible compels you to become a participant in the story. Simply put, the Bible is about God. It tells the true story of creation from His perspective. It is about God revealing Himself to men and women who are, in some respects, like Him, and who were made to have a relationship with Him. As you read, you will discover that God has a plan for you and for all of creation. Though that plan has been corrupted by failure, God has not abandoned us. Those who enter into His story can experience what it means to enjoy life both now and forever. Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament books, called the story of the Bible good news. In the book of Romans, he wrote, "I am not ashamed of the good news, because it is the power of God for saving everyone who believes the wonderful message of God's love that has been made known in Jesus Christ." I hope this book not only helps and encourages you to read the Bible, but also convinces you to join in God's story, which is also your story. 1. From Creation to Babel. Main characters: God, the Lord, Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel, Noah. Setting: Mesopotamia. Creation. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In its original state, the earth was empty and dark. Like a bird watching over its young, the Spirit of God hovered over the watery surface of the earth. God created light on day one. On day two, He placed the sky between the earth and the heavens. He made land and vegetation on the third day, and on the fourth day, He put the stars, the sun, and the moon in place. On day 5, God filled the sky with birds and the oceans with creatures of the sea. God created animals on the 6th day, and finally, last but not least, he made humankind in his image. This means they were like God in certain ways. God enriched their lives by providing them food to eat and giving them responsibility for the rest of creation. When God finished his work, he saw that everything he had made was perfect. There was absolutely no defect in his creation. He rested on the 7th day and set it apart as a day to rest and to remember that God is the creator of the universe. The Lord God planted a garden in Eden and made Adam the caretaker. He made all kinds of trees grow in the garden, and in the middle of the garden, he designated 2 trees as the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life. The Lord gave man permission to eat from all of the trees in the garden, except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He warned Adam that if he disobeyed by eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, he would immediately die spiritually and eventually die physically. The Lord allowed Adam to name all the animals so he would realize none of them were made like him. But the Lord also knew Adam needed a wife. When Adam fell into a deep sleep, the Lord made a woman from Adam's rib. When Adam woke up, he was thrilled. The woman was perfect. Adam called her woman because she was made from his side. God united them in marriage, and though they were naked, they did not feel embarrassed or think about exploiting each other. The Fall. Their relationship with the Lord and each other couldn't have been better until Satan came to Eve in the disguise of a snake and raised doubt in her mind about the integrity of God's prohibition. Satan lied and told Eve she would become like God and would be able to make moral decisions independent of God. Satan's argument made sense. When Eve looked at the fruit, it looked good to eat, so she decided to eat it and then gave some to Adam. They immediately realized they had sinned. Both were overwhelmed with guilt and were shocked when they saw they were naked. Adam and Eve awkwardly tried to cover their nakedness by sewing fig leaves together. When the Lord returned to the garden, Adam and Eve were so afraid they tried to hide. It didn't work. The Lord knew what had happened. When Adam and Eve didn't meet him, the Lord called out, "Where are you?" Like a criminal caught in the act, Adam tried to cover up his sin. He told the Lord he was afraid because he was naked. He was actually afraid because he knew the Lord would punish him for his disobedience. When the Lord asked Adam if he had eaten the forbidden fruit, Adam tried to blame Eve. He said it was her fault. She had given him the fruit. The Lord then asked Eve what had happened, and she blamed Satan. She admitted Satan had deceived her. Because Satan had taken the form of a snake to deceive Eve, the Lord cursed both the snake and Satan. The Lord said Satan would be humiliated and would grovel in dust like a snake crawls on the ground. The Lord also predicted there would be a constant struggle between the followers of Satan and the descendants of the woman, but one of Eve's descendants would eventually crush the head of Satan. As a consequence of her disobedience, the Lord said Eve would suffer pain in bearing children, and Adam and Eve's marriage relationship would suffer from a sinister conflict. Eve now would have a sinful desire to control and manipulate Adam. Adam would attempt to dominate and exploit Eve. Because Adam had listened to his wife and had eaten the forbidden fruit, he would always struggle to eat. The soil of the earth would become his enemy. It would produce thorns and thistles. Adam would die, and his body would return to the ground from which he was created. But the Lord was also kind-hearted to Adam and Eve. He covered their nakedness with the skin of an animal. Because of their sin, Adam and Eve forfeited the opportunity to eat from the tree of life. So the Lord expelled them from the garden and ordered angels to guard the tree of life. The sons of Adam and Eve. Adam slept with Eve, and she became pregnant and gave birth to a son. She was amazed. She was able to produce life just like the Lord had done. She named her son Cain and thanked the Lord for giving her a son. She then had another son, Abel. When the two boys became adults, they chose different occupations. Abel became a herdsman and Cain a farmer. They both brought an offering to the Lord. Cain merely fulfilled an obligation by bringing some of his harvest, but Abel did his best to honor the Lord, bringing some of the best animals from his herd. God approved of Abel's offering, but not Cain's. This made Cain furious. He was red hot with anger. The Lord tried to warn Cain. He told him his uncontrolled rage would lead to violence. Cain refused to listen. He tricked his brother by inviting him into one of his fields and then killed him. The Lord knew what Cain had done, but asked him a rhetorical question. Where is your brother Abel? Cain defiantly lied and said he didn't know. He then expressed his contempt for the Lord with his own rhetorical question. Am I my brother's keeper? The Lord told Cain there was an eyewitness to his crime. It was his brother's blood crying out from the ground. Because of Cain's heinous murder of his own brother, the Lord banished him from the ground he had cultivated for his livelihood. Realizing he could not survive as a homeless wanderer, Cain was desperate. He complained that his punishment was more than he could endure. Someone would undoubtedly kill him if he was a homeless wanderer. The Lord understood and assured Cain of special protection. Cain was satisfied, but he refused to stay in the presence of the Lord. He went east and lived in the land of Nod, which means land of wandering. Cain married, and his wife had a son, Enoch. Instead of accepting his punishment, Cain started a city in the east and named it after Enoch. Enoch had several sons, including Lamech. Lamech married two wives, Ada and Zillah. Jabal, his son by Ada, became the first shepherd, and Tubal-Cain, his son by Zillah, was the first to make tools of metal. Lamech killed a man who offended him. Knowing he might be held accountable, he boasted to his wives that if anyone tried to punish him, he would kill that person as well. Eve had another son. She named him Seth, which means in place of, because Cain had killed Abel. During the lifetime of Enosh, Seth's son, people began to worship the Lord through prayer and sacrifice. Noah. Adam lived for 800 years after he became the father of Seth. He was 930 when he died. The descendants from Adam to Noah lived for hundreds of years, but they all eventually died just as the Lord had said they would. There was one exception. Because Enoch was fully devoted to the Lord, God suspended the penalty of death and took him from the earth. One of Adam's descendants, Lamech, had a son at age 182 and named him Noah, which means comfort, because he hoped his son would bring relief from the harsh struggle of living under the curse on the ground. During the lifetime of Noah, there was a population explosion. The sons of God lusted after beautiful women and married them. There are three major views on the identity of the sons of God. One, they were fallen angels who took human bodies to cohabit with women. Two, they were godly descendants in the line of Seth, and the daughters of men were in the ungodly line of Cain. Or three, they were powerful tyrants who forced themselves on attractive women. Their children were called Nephilim. Some believe the Nephilim were mighty warriors, descendants of the union between the sons of God and the daughters of men. Nephilim are mentioned later in Numbers chapter 13, verse 33, but they could not be descendants of the Nephilim in this passage, since all humanity, except for Noah and his extended family, were destroyed in the flood. Nephilim is probably a general term referring to physical giants or powerful warriors. The Nephilim became famous superheroes and dominated the world. Until now, the Spirit of the Lord had spared humanity from judgment because of sin, but the Lord warned he would only withhold judgment for another 120 years. A rampant explosion of wickedness throughout the earth both broke the heart of the Lord and made him angry. He was extremely disappointed in the people he had made, but made the painful decision to destroy everything he had created. In contrast to his contemporaries, Noah was a man of integrity and had a special relationship with God. His sons were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. The rest of humanity was totally corrupt. There was complete anarchy. Because of Noah and God's close relationship, God did not want to destroy Noah with the rest of humanity. God revealed his plan to Noah to destroy the world with a flood and ordered him to build an ark out of gopher wood, probably cypress, and cover it entirely with pitch. He instructed Noah to build it so that it would not capsize during the flood. God said to build it with three decks, but no windows, only an opening for ventilation 18 inches from the top deck. Though there had never been a flood, Noah believed God and built the ark exactly as instructed. After Noah finished building the ark, the Lord told him to take 7 pairs of every clean animal, 2 pairs of every unclean animal, and 7 pairs of every species of birds into the ark. The distinction between clean and unclean animals is based on differences as defined in the law of Moses. The Lord then warned Noah the rain would begin in 7 days and would continue for 40 days and nights. At age 600, Noah brought his wife, his sons and their wives, and all the animals on board. As soon as he finished loading, the rain began. In addition to the rain, gigantic tidal waves from the ocean swept across the earth, covering it for 150 days. Everything was destroyed. Only Noah and those on the ark survived. After the flood, God kept his promise to Noah and all the animals on the ark. He closed the huge underground caverns of water that had broken open, and he stopped the rain. He sent a powerful wind to accelerate the evaporation of water. There are 2 views on the extent of the flood. Some believe it was universal, covering all the earth. Others believe it was local and destroyed life only in populated areas. After 150 days, the ark landed somewhere on the mountains of Ararat, southeast of the Black Sea, bordering on today's Turkey, Armenia, and Iran. Noah and his family stayed in the ark for another 2.5 months until the waters had receded enough for them to see the tops of other mountains. To make certain it was safe to leave the ark, Noah released 2 birds. First, he released a raven that flew until it found a place to land and did not return. Second, he released a dove that returned because it could not find a place to land. Noah waited 7 more days, then released the dove again. When the dove returned with an olive leaf in its beak, Noah knew there was dry land. But to be absolutely certain, Noah waited another 7 days and released the dove a third time. This time, the dove did not come back. Noah was now 601. It had been 10.5 months since the beginning of the flood, and Noah felt it was safe to remove the top covering of the ark. He could see dry land, but he waited another 2 months until the earth around him was completely dry. Just as God had ordered Noah to board the ark, God ordered Noah to leave the ark and release all the animals to repopulate the earth. After he had set the animals free, Noah built an altar and sacrificed some of the approved animals and birds to thank the Lord for delivering him and his family from the flood. The Lord accepted Noah's sacrifices and was delighted with them. Though Adam's sin had permanently corrupted humankind, the Lord swore he would never totally destroy the world again. He promised there would always be a cycle of seasons to sustain life. God blessed Noah and told him to repopulate the earth. Prior to the sin of Adam and Eve, the Lord had given humans dominion over animals, but had not allowed them to eat meat. Now God gave humans permission to eat meat, but said animals would fear people, perhaps because people would hunt them for food. As a reminder of the high value of life, God did not permit the eating of blood, not because blood was unhealthy, but because blood was a symbol of life. God warned he would demand the life of anybody who killed, by implication, murdered someone. To assure Noah and all humanity he would never again destroy life with a flood, God designated the rainbow as a special sign. Unfortunately, the flood did not eliminate the problem of sin. The tragedy of sin overtook Noah and his sons. Noah got drunk on wine he had made from the vineyard he himself had planted. In his stupor, Noah removed all his clothes. When his son Ham entered Noah's tent, instead of respecting his father by covering his nakedness, he did nothing and told his brothers. His brothers, Shem and Japheth, exercised extreme caution so they would not humiliate Noah by looking at his nakedness. They entered his tent backwards and carefully covered their father with a large blanket. When Noah realized what Ham had done, he said Ham's flagrant act of disrespect would have consequences on future generations. Because his moral conduct exposed a serious character defect, Noah predicted Ham's son, Canaan, and his descendants would be oppressed by others. Noah also prophesied that God would bless the descendants of Japheth and Shem because they had shown respect for their father. Genesis chapter 10 contains what is called the Table of Nations. Though the list comes before the account of the Tower of Babel in the book of Genesis, it shows the dispersion of the nations in the ancient Near East after God's judgment at Babel. It contains the names of individuals, tribes, nations, and even cities. All the people listed are in some way connected to Shem, Ham, and Japheth, the three sons of Noah. The Tower of Babel. The consequences of Adam and Eve's sin surfaced again in rebellion against God in Shinar, the ancient region of Babylonia or southern Mesopotamia. This area is today's country of Iraq. As the population began to increase after the flood, God commanded people to repopulate all of the earth. Instead of obeying, they settled on a plain in Shinar. Because stone was scarce in that area, they developed the technology to make bricks and constructed a city. Motivated by pride and the desire to establish some kind of powerful humanistic empire, the rebels erected a skyscraper type of temple tower in the city center. The rebels' blatant defiance of the Lord did not go unnoticed. There was no limit to what they might do if God did not stop them. At this time in civilization's development, everyone spoke the same language. The Lord, knowing exactly how to stop them, confused them with different languages and forced them to scatter all over the world. The tower was given the name Babel. This is a play on words. In Hebrew, Babel means confusion, but in Babylonian literature, it refers to the Gate of God. Chapter Summary. God created the earth and the whole universe in 6 days. As the climatic act, he made Adam and Eve. When he had finished his work, God rested on the seventh day. He placed Adam and Eve in Eden and provided everything they needed to live and enjoy life. He gave them instructions on how to live and warned them not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Satan deceived Eve. She and Adam disobeyed God. God told Satan, Eve, and Adam what their punishments would be, and he assured Eve that one of her descendants would triumph over Satan. He covered their nakedness, but banished them from the garden. Eve gave birth to Cain and later to Abel. Abel did his best to respect God, but Cain was godless. Cain killed Abel because he was jealous of Abel's relationship with God. As God had warned, Adam died. Because his sin affected the whole human race, as the population increased, the world became corrupt and violent. This broke the Lord's heart, but it made him so angry that he decided to destroy the world. Noah was a good man. To protect Noah from the coming flood, God told him to build an ark for his family and for animals. After the flood, God commanded Noah to repopulate the earth. He promised he would never destroy the world again with a flood, and gave the rainbow as his promise. Instead of spreading out as God had ordered, people gathered to build a city and a tower. Because everyone spoke the same language, God put an end to their rebellion by confusing their tongues and scattering them across the earth. The story of the Bible now narrows from the history of humanity generally to focus on Abraham and his descendants. 2. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Jacob's sons. Main characters: Abraham, Sarah, Ishmael, Isaac, Esau, Jacob, Joseph. Setting: Mesopotamia, Ur and Haran, land of Canaan, Egypt. Abraham. Terah was a descendant of Shem, one of Noah's three sons. Terah also had three sons, one of whom was Abraham. While Terah and his family lived in Ur, the Lord appeared to Abraham. He told him, "Leave your country, your father's family, and go to a new land that I will show you. I will bless you, make you into a great nation, and bring a blessing to all people through you." The promise to bless all people was ultimately fulfilled through Jesus Christ, a descendant of Abraham. After God had spoken to Abraham, Terah moved his family to Haran. Abraham lived in Haran for several years, though the city was not in the land God had promised him. After the death of his father, Abraham moved to Canaan with his wife, Sarah, and his nephew, Lot. At this time, in the promised land, Abraham had to live like a nomad, moving from place to place because the Canaanites occupied the parts of the land that were fertile. God appeared to Abraham a second time and again promised his descendants would possess the land. Abraham worshipped the Lord by building a stone altar. A severe famine then forced Abraham to move to Egypt. Because Sarah was extremely attractive, Abraham was afraid the Egyptians would kill him and abduct his wife, so Abraham lied. He told the Egyptians that Sarah was his sister. The ruler of Egypt, Pharaoh, a title, not a name, was captivated by Sarah's beauty and attempted to take her as one of his wives. When the Lord inflicted terrible diseases on Pharaoh's household, he became suspicious and accused Abraham of lying. When Abraham admitted that Sarah was his wife, Pharaoh ordered him to leave Egypt. Abraham returned to Canaan and decided to live in Bethel, where he had previously built an altar to the Lord. Abraham and Lot were grazing their sheep together, and both had become extremely wealthy. Their herdsmen quarreled over grazing rights, so the two men agreed to separate. Lot chose to live near Sodom, though the people in that area were exceedingly wicked. After the departure of Lot, the Lord again assured Abraham that he would give him the land as far as the eye could see, and predicted his descendants would be as numerous as the sand. Abraham built another altar to the Lord at Hebron. When war broke out between kings in the region, one of the kings and his allies plundered the city of Sodom. They captured Lot and withdrew to the north. When Abraham found out his nephew had been captured, he organized 318 of his best warriors and pursued Lot's captors. He caught up with them north of Damascus and rescued Lot and all the other captives from Sodom. After Abraham returned, the priest king Melchizedek blessed him, recognizing God as creator and the one who had given Abraham victory. Melchizedek means king of righteousness. Abraham expressed his appreciation to Melchizedek by giving him a tenth of the valuable goods he had captured. When he gave back the captives to the king of Sodom, the king offered to reward Abraham. But Abraham refused because he did not want to become indebted to an ungodly king. When Abraham decided to designate Eliezer, his most trusted servant, as his heir, since he still didn't have a son, the Lord reassured Abraham that he would give him his own son. The Lord told Abraham to count the stars if he could, and then said, "Your descendants will be like the stars, too many to count." Abraham reaffirmed his trust in God's promises by making an animal sacrifice, and the Lord himself passed between the animals in the visible form of a smoking fire pot and flaming torch, assuring Abraham that God could be trusted. He promised that Abraham's descendants would possess the land from Egypt in the south to the Euphrates River in the north. the Lord would allow the Amorites, one of the nations living in Canaan, to occupy the land for 400 years before removing them because of their sin. Sarah became so impatient, she refused to wait any longer for a son. She told Abraham to sleep with Hagar, her Egyptian servant. In the ancient Near East, a husband could produce an heir by his wife's servant if his wife could not have children. After Hagar became pregnant, she ridiculed Sarah, and Sarah despised Hagar. When Hagar attempted to run away because Sarah mistreated her, the angel of the Lord told her to return and submit to Sarah's authority and promised Hagar her son would be great. When Hagar gave birth to her son, Abraham named him Ishmael. Abraham was 80. God appeared again to Abraham when the patriarch was 90. He revealed himself as God Almighty and challenged Abraham to serve him faithfully. He expanded the original covenant, promising to make Abraham the father of many nations and assuring him it would be an everlasting covenant. He told Abraham to circumcise himself and every male child in his household. God made this ancient rite the distinguishing sign that Abraham and his descendants were God's covenant people. God again promised to give Abraham and Sarah a son. The idea was so ridiculous that Abraham laughed to himself because he was 100 and Sarah was 90. To encourage the patriarch, the Lord told him to name his son Isaac, which means he laughs, and promised he would be born in a year's time. Later, three angels in the form of men visited Abraham's camp. When Sarah overheard one of them tell Abraham that within a year Sarah would have a son, she laughed because she thought her body was so old she could never become pregnant. The angel was the Lord himself, and he asked Abraham why Sarah had laughed. Sarah was so afraid that she denied she had scoffed at the Lord's promise. As the three men were about to leave, the Lord decided to tell Abraham their intention to totally destroy the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah because they had become so evil. Abraham knew Lot and his family were still living in Sodom, so he pleaded with the Lord to spare at least 10 people. The Lord graciously agreed. Lot held some kind of official position in Sodom, so when two visitors arrived at the city gate, Lot invited them to stay at his house. The men of the city had become so perverse that when they spotted the visitors, they surrounded Lot's house and demanded he turn the visitors over to them for sex. Instead, Lot offered them his daughters. The mob became violent, and the angels blinded them. Then they ordered Lot to get all his relatives out of the city immediately because they intended to destroy the whole area. Lot was hesitant to leave, so the angels forcibly removed him, his wife, and two daughters. Outside the city, the angels told Lot to flee and not look back. After Lot was safe, the Lord totally destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah with an eruption of fire and sulfur. Lot reached the village of Zoar, but in disobedience to the angel's command, his wife looked back, and in consequence was turned into a pillar of salt. Lot hid in a cave with his two daughters because he was afraid of the men in Zoar. His daughters thought all the men in the area had been killed, so they conspired to get their father drunk so they could have children. The oldest slept with her father first, and the next night the youngest. They conceived, and the oldest gave birth to Moab, who became the father of the Moabites, and the youngest to Ammon, who became the father of the Ammonites. When Abraham moved to the Negev, he lied again. He told Abimelech, a powerful ruler, that Sarah was his sister. Abimelech, most likely a dynastic rather than a personal name, means my father the king. Abimelech had Sarah brought to his palace, but fortunately, before he slept with her, the Lord warned him in a dream that Sarah was married. Abraham had been wrong about Abimelech. He was an honorable man. When he realized Abraham had lied, Abimelech returned Sarah to him and even compensated the patriarch with 1,000 pieces of silver for his mistake. Abraham prayed for Abimelech and his household, for the Lord had made all the women infertile because Abimelech had placed Sarah in his harem. The Lord then surprised both Abraham and Sarah with the impossible. Sarah conceived in her old age and gave birth to a son. Abraham named him Isaac and circumcised him on the eighth day as God had commanded. Sarah was delighted and declared, "God has brought me laughter." When Ishmael ridiculed his stepbrother, Sarah demanded that Abraham banish Hagar and her son. The Lord assured Abraham that Sarah's demand was part of his plan to bless Isaac. Abraham provided food and water for Hagar and Ishmael and sent them into the wilderness of Beersheba. They almost died in the desert's heat, but God mercifully provided water and again promised to make Ishmael the father of a great nation. Ishmael grew up in the desert and married an Egyptian. In an arid region, Abraham again found himself in a conflict over water rights. His shepherds fought over a well at Beersheba with the shepherds of Abimelech, a Philistine. Abimelech could see Abraham was a man blessed by God, so he made a peace treaty with him rather than risk God's judgment. Then God shocked Abraham, testing his faith by telling him to offer Isaac, the son he greatly loved, as a sacrifice. Though an astounding command, Abraham obeyed. He climbed a mountain in the region of Moriah, built an altar, and prepared to sacrifice his son. Instead, the Lord unexpectedly provided a ram as a substitute sacrifice. Abraham named the place Jehovah Provides. Because Abraham had been willing to sacrifice his own son, the Lord reaffirmed his promise to bless Abraham and make him a blessing to the nations. Sarah died at age 127. Abraham purchased a field and a cave for her gravesite in the land God had promised to give him. Before Abraham died, he made arrangements for a wife for Isaac. Because he did not want Isaac to marry a Canaanite, he sent his most trusted servant to find a wife among his own people who lived in the region of Haran. The servant stopped at a well. After asking the Lord for guidance, he met Rebekah. When he explained to Laban, her father, the nature of his journey, Laban realized this was providential, and he explained to his daughter the purpose of the man's visit. Rebekah agreed to go with Abraham's servant. When they arrived in Canaan, Isaac took Rebekah as his wife and fell in love with her. After the death of Sarah, Abraham married Keturah and had several sons and grandsons. Abraham also had more sons by concubines. Though he provided for all his sons before he died at age 175, Abraham willed his inheritance to Isaac. Both Isaac and Ishmael buried their father in the cave at Machpelah, where Abraham had buried Sarah. Ishmael fathered 12 sons, who became the heads of 12 tribes. They lived in an area from Havilah to Shur in north-central Arabia. Ishmael died at age 137. Isaac. Rebekah gave birth to 2 sons. Contrary to ancient custom, God told her he planned to make the younger son greater than the older. Esau was born first. They named their second son Jacob because he was grasping Esau's heel when he was born. The name Jacob is similar to the Hebrew word for heel. Though twins, the two boys were radically different. Esau became an excellent hunter and loved the outdoors. However, he lived by his passions and had little regard for his privileged position as the firstborn son. Jacob was the stay-at-home type, but he was ambitious and manipulative. He also had a serious problem with integrity. Isaac favored Esau, for he would bring him savory wild game. Rebekah favored Jacob. Jacob cunningly obtained Esau's inheritance. When Esau returned from hunting, he complained he was starving to death and asked for food. Jacob replied, "First, sell me your birthright." Esau was so famished that he traded his firstborn inheritance for a bowl of red stew. His descendants eventually lived in an area distinguished by red cliffs. Like Abraham, Isaac was forced to move south because of a severe famine. He thought about moving to Egypt, but the Lord said, "Stay here, and I will bless you. Your descendants will be as numerous as the stars, and they will be a blessing to all nations of the earth." Isaac decided to stay in the south of the promised land. Though Isaac was a man of faith, he was far from perfect. Because Rebekah was attractive, Isaac told the men of Gerar that she was his sister because he thought they might kill him and abduct her. When the Philistine king spotted Isaac embracing her, he knew she wasn't his sister. The king issued a warning that no one should touch Rebekah because she was Isaac's wife. The Lord blessed Isaac. He became wealthy and powerful, so wealthy that the region's king asked him to leave. Though Isaac moved, his flocks were so large there was not enough water for them and those of the local shepherds. Isaac moved again, this time to Beersheba, where the Lord assured him he had nothing to fear. Isaac worshipped the Lord and made Beersheba his home. This was wise. The king made a nonviolent treaty with Isaac, and Isaac's servants found water while digging a well at Beersheba. Esau continued to live as a godless rebel. Instead of finding a wife from his own people, he married Judith and Basemath, who were the daughters of foreigners. Jacob again resorted to deception to obtain the patriarchal blessing that customarily would have been given to his older brother. When Isaac was old and had extremely poor eyesight, Rebekah helped Jacob disguise himself so Isaac would think he was Esau. The ruse worked, and Isaac blessed Jacob. Jacob. Esau, who was furious, threatened to kill his brother. Rebekah warned Jacob to flee for his life. Before Jacob left, Isaac blessed his son and told him not to marry a Canaanite. Jacob went to Haran, where his uncle lived. Jacob worked as a shepherd for Laban, who had two daughters, Leah and Rachel. Jacob fell in love with Rachel, the youngest. He asked Laban for permission to marry her, agreeing to work 7 years as Laban's servant. The man who had used deception to manipulate others met his match in Laban. On the wedding night, Laban gave Leah to Jacob to be his wife instead of Rachel. When Jacob realized he had been tricked, he complained. Laban replied that it was customary for the oldest daughter to marry first. To marry Rachel, Jacob was forced to commit to another 7 years of work. Jacob's wives competed with each other for his favor. Though Jacob loved Rachel most, Rachel was unable to conceive. The Lord, however, blessed Leah with 4 sons. In desperation, Rachel told Jacob to sleep with her servant to bear a son. Leah then allowed Jacob to sleep with her servant to give him another son. Finally, in answer to her prayers, the Lord gave Rachel a son, whom she named Joseph, which means, "May he add." This expressed Rachel's hope that the Lord would give her even another son. Rachel and Leah and their 2 servants gave Jacob a total of 12 sons and 1 daughter. Jacob's 12 sons would become the leaders of the 12 tribes of Israel. After the birth of Joseph, Jacob began making plans to return to the land of Canaan. His uncle pleaded with him to stay. Jacob had made Laban extremely wealthy. He reluctantly agreed to let Jacob leave, but was only willing to give him a small flock of sheep. Jacob, an extremely skillful shepherd, still was able to increase the size and quality of his flock. When Jacob realized Laban's sons resented him because of his success, he decided to leave secretly. He informed his wives, but told them not to tell their father. Laban discovered Jacob's departure and pursued. When he caught Jacob, the 2 men argued, but finally agreed to a peaceful settlement. Jacob built a stone monument to mark the location and offered a sacrifice to God. Jacob had another problem to overcome before he could return home. He sent his servants ahead to find out if Esau was still angry enough to kill him. When the messengers reported that Esau was coming to meet him with 400 armed men, Jacob asked the Lord for protection and sent ahead a gift of several 100 animals. The day before he met Esau, Jacob sent his family across the Jabbok River and stayed by himself in the camp. During the night, Jacob encountered a man and wrestled with him until dawn. The man was a visible, physical appearance of the Lord. The man dislocated Jacob's hip, but Jacob grabbed his opponent and would not release him until he blessed him. "What is your name?" the man asked. "Jacob," was the reply. "It isn't anymore," the man told him. "It is Israel, one who fought with God." The man blessed Jacob, and Jacob called the place Peniel, which means the face of God, because he had survived a face-to-face encounter with the Lord. Jacob walked with a limp because of the severity of the blow to his hip. Early in the morning, Jacob saw Esau and his men approaching. He went out ahead of his family, but instead of attacking, Esau ran to meet his brother. The two men embraced, and Jacob introduced his family to Esau. Esau offered to escort Jacob to his home in Seir, but Jacob declined. Instead, he purchased land in Shechem, and as a witness of his faith, he built an altar to the Lord. Though the Lord had promised the land of Canaan to Abraham and his descendants, it was not a safe place for Jacob. The relationship between his family and the people of Shechem was disastrous. Shechem, a Hivite, raped Leah's daughter, Dinah. Shechem told his father, King Hamor, that he loved Dinah, so the king asked Jacob for permission for his son to marry Dinah. Dinah's outraged brothers plotted revenge. They told the men of Shechem they could marry into their family only if they were circumcised. The men agreed, and all were circumcised. While they were incapacitated, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brothers, rescued Dinah, killed all of Shechem's men, and then plundered the city. Jacob, shocked by what his sons had done, feared the other Canaanites would destroy them. Because of the threat, Jacob ordered his extended household to completely trust in the Lord by destroying all their idols. They moved to Bethel, where Jacob had first built an altar. The Lord reaffirmed the Abrahamic promise to Jacob, and Jacob built another altar to him. They intended to go to Ephrath, also called Bethlehem, but Rachel died giving birth to her second son, Benjamin, before they arrived in the city. Isaac died at age 180. Jacob and Esau buried him at Mamre, Hebron, where Abraham had lived. Esau, who married three Canaanite women, moved south to Mount Seir because there was not enough land to support his livestock and Jacob's. The descendants of Esau were known as Edomites, and the area where his descendants settled was called Edom. Joseph. Jacob made Canaan his permanent home. His 12 sons shepherded his large flocks, but there was trouble in his family. Though Joseph was not his oldest, Jacob favored him and gave him a beautiful robe, indicating that he intended to give Joseph most of the family inheritance. Joseph's brothers resented this and despised Joseph. The relationship deteriorated even further when Joseph had two dreams revealing that his brothers and even his parents would bow to honor him. The brothers' hostility exploded in violence while they were grazing their flocks in an isolated location. Jacob sent Joseph to check on them, but when he found them, they assaulted him and took his fancy robe. They planned to kill him, but Reuben pleaded that they not do so. Instead, they sold him to merchants who were on their way to Egypt. They smeared Joseph's robe with goat blood and told their father that Joseph had been killed by a wild animal, and they produced his bloody robe as evidence. In Egypt, Potiphar, a military officer, bought Joseph to be his household slave. His wife tried repeatedly to seduce Joseph, but Joseph refused to sin because of his commitment to Potiphar and to God. In a last desperate attempt to seduce Joseph, she grabbed his cloak and said, "Let's have sex." Joseph ran from the house, leaving Potiphar's wife holding his cloak. Scorned, she accused him of rape and used his cloak as evidence. Instead of executing Joseph, Potiphar had him put into prison. Though his brothers had betrayed Joseph, God had not abandoned him. the Lord continued to speak to Joseph through dreams. Two other prisoners, one who had been Pharaoh's cupbearer and the other his baker, asked Joseph to interpret their dreams. Joseph told the cupbearer he would be restored to his former position. The baker would be executed. He asked the cupbearer to remember how he had helped him, but the man seemed to have forgotten about Joseph when he was reinstated. Years later, the Lord worked providentially to fulfill his purpose for Joseph. Pharaoh, the king, had dreams his advisors could not interpret. Then Pharaoh's cupbearer remembered Joseph's ability to interpret dreams. He informed Pharaoh, who ordered Joseph released and asked him to interpret the dreams that had baffled his other advisors. Joseph gave the king good news and bad news. He told the ruler his dreams were prophetic about the future economic conditions in Egypt. Joseph predicted 7 years of prosperity, followed by 7 years of hardship. Pharaoh was impressed and made Joseph the second highest ruler in Egypt. As Joseph had predicted, Egypt enjoyed 7 years of abundant harvest and then suffered 7 years of devastating famine. During the prosperity, Joseph strategically stored grain for Pharaoh. When the famine struck, landowners were forced to sell their land to Pharaoh to survive. Pharaoh became extremely wealthy. Joseph, very powerful. The famine was severe and widespread. It affected the land of Canaan, and Jacob's sons were forced to go to Egypt to buy grain. On their first visit, Joseph's brothers didn't recognize him, but he knew them and remembered his dreams that they would bow before him. Instead of identifying himself, Joseph accused them of spying on Egypt and imprisoned them. After 3 days, he released them but said that to prove they were not spies, they had to leave a hostage and bring their youngest brother back when they returned again. They left Simeon. Joseph ordered his servants to give them grain and hide their money in their grain sacks. When they arrived in Canaan, they told Jacob an Egyptian ruler had imprisoned Simeon as a hostage and demanded they return to Egypt with their youngest brother, Benjamin. Jacob refused. He had lost two sons, Joseph and now Simeon, and he didn't want to lose his only other son by Rachel. Because of the severity of the famine, Jacob, now called Israel, eventually was forced to send his sons back to Egypt, and he reluctantly agreed to let them take Benjamin after Judah promised he would protect him. On their second trip, Joseph's brothers expected trouble, but were astonished at being treated like honored guests. Joseph tested them one more time before identifying himself. He wanted to find out if they would abandon Benjamin as they had abandoned him. He ordered his servant to secretly place his silver cup in Benjamin's grain sack. After they began their journey back to Canaan, Joseph sent his servant after them. He accused them of stealing and said the thief would become Joseph's slave. They denied the charge and agreed that if any of them were found to have stolen the silver cup, he would become Joseph's slave. They were shocked when the cup was found with Benjamin. When Judah pleaded for mercy, Joseph could no longer control his emotions. He wept and said to his brothers, "I am Joseph." They were astonished and terrified. Joseph, however, assured them they had nothing to fear. He realized that though their intentions had been evil, God had sent him to Egypt to save their lives by making him an advisor to Pharaoh and ruler over the land. Joseph told them to return to Canaan and bring their father and their families to Egypt. When they returned and told their father that Joseph was alive and had become a powerful ruler, Israel didn't believe them. They were able to convince him by telling him what Joseph had said and showing him the provisions he had sent. Israel agreed to make the journey to Egypt. While on his way, the Lord confirmed to the patriarch that this was all part of his plan to make Israel into a great nation. Joseph asked Pharaoh for permission to settle his family in the land of Goshen and assured the king they were self-sufficient. After Israel, who was now 130, arrived in Egypt, Joseph introduced him to Pharaoh, and Israel blessed the king. Under Joseph's administration, the people of Egypt were able to survive the famine, but ultimately had to give their land to Pharaoh in exchange for food. The people became Pharaoh's servants, and he assumed responsibility for their care. Israel blessed Joseph's sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, but elevated Ephraim over Manasseh, even though Manasseh was the oldest. Israel also predicted what would happen in the future for each of his sons, and he instructed them to bury him in the land promised to Abraham. When Israel died, Joseph honored his father's request and buried him in Canaan. Now that Israel was dead, Joseph's brothers expected him to take revenge. But instead, he made a remarkable statement of faith. He declared, "Don't be afraid. Am I in God's place? You intended evil, but God intended it for good, to accomplish the saving of many lives." Before he himself died, Joseph blessed his two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, and made his brothers promise to take his remains back to the land that God had promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Chapter summary. As the Lord had made a covenant with Noah to sustain the earth, he entered into a covenant relationship with Abraham that ultimately would bring a blessing to all people. The Lord promised Abraham a new homeland and descendants as numerous as the stars. Abraham believed God's amazing promise and left his home for the land of Canaan. Abraham discovered that nothing is impossible with God. Sarah gave birth to Isaac when they were so old they had abandoned all hope of ever having children. After Isaac's birth, the Lord tested Abraham's faith by telling him to offer his son as a sacrifice. Abraham obeyed. He built an altar, but the Lord provided an animal as a substitute. Isaac and Rebekah had two sons. Jacob persuaded Esau to sell him the family inheritance, which was rightfully Esau's as the oldest. When Isaac was nearing death, Jacob deceived him to obtain his father's blessing intended for the oldest son. Jacob experienced a turning point in his life when he struggled with the Lord all night. His name was changed to Israel. He fathered 12 sons who would become the leaders of the 12 tribes. Joseph, his favorite, became first a household slave, then an alleged rapist, and finally the chief economic advisor to the king of Egypt. Joseph guided the nation through extreme prosperity and severe famine. When he rediscovered his brothers, instead of seeking revenge, he provided for them and moved them all to Egypt. Joseph realized that God had providentially used his brothers' attempt to destroy him for the preservation of his family. Before Joseph died, he asked his brothers to take his bones back to the land God had promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. 3. Moses and the Exodus. Main characters: Moses, Pharaoh, the Egyptian king, the Lord, God's covenant name, Yahweh, the sons of Israel, Israelites. Setting: Egypt, Red Sea, Sinai Peninsula, Mount Sinai. Moses. After the death of Joseph, the children of Israel prospered in Egypt. Their explosive growth in size and power alarmed the Egyptians. When a new pharaoh, who didn't know what Joseph had done for Egypt, came to power, he feared the Israelites and enslaved their entire population. But their numbers continued to increase. Pharaoh was so threatened that he ordered the midwives to kill all the Hebrew, Israelite, male children at birth. The midwives, however, refused to obey his murderous edict because they honored God more than Pharaoh. Moses did not aspire to become the leader of Israel. He was thrust into the position by providential circumstances. When Moses was born, his mother recognized him as a special child and tried to hide him. When that was no longer possible, she placed him in a reed basket and set him afloat on the Nile River. The daughter of Pharaoh found the infant, adopted him, and chose Moses' mother as his nurse. When he had grown up, Moses killed an Egyptian who was beating a Hebrew. Instead of recognizing Moses as their leader, his own people threatened to report him to Pharaoh. Moses fled to Midian, southern Sinai Peninsula, and didn't plan to return. He became a shepherd and married Zipporah, the daughter of Jethro. One day, when he was tending sheep, Moses saw a strange phenomenon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.